Y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old church.
That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was going to say. Sisters got happy, folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
And I won't be long, but I'm still in the book of Matthew, chapter 13. Say amen when you can, verse number 19. And I just need to know before I start preaching the word of God that you're ready to praise God.
Amen.
That you're ready to praise God.
Amen.
That you're ready to receive God's word. For he's worthy to be praised. Amen.
Amen.
And I'm just so glad that I'm with folk that are ready to praise God with all of their soul and all their might, all they have in them, to give God his praise. He's worthy to be praised. I don't care what this world says, there is a God.
Amen.
He is alive.
Yes,
and he's coming back again. There's a God. And one day, God's coming back again. And there are a lot of things that we've said that we will be held accountable to the things we've said and done in this body, whether good or bad, according to the book of Romans 14:12. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, God is coming back again to hold man accountable, but most of all, to bring salvation to all of those who have done according to his holy divine will. We hope, trust, and pray. If you're here today and you're not a member of the Lord's church, one of you found in the Bible, one that is substantiated by the doctrine, and one he shall receive again up in glory, according to Ephesians 5:21, it's our prayer that you will give God his due benevolence, his love, and become a member of the Lord's church before it's everlasting and eternal too late. It is for this cause we preach the gospel, and then we give it to you and those of you that are members of the Lord's church. It is time for you to take a cursory look at your soul salvation, explore and invite yourself into the will of God. And if you stand a guilty distance, if you have been outside of the will of God, in this lesson, even while I'm preaching, you can get up and say, I repent of my sin, and I've come to a place, I admit I've done wrong, and you can get it right before it's everlasting and eternal way. This is an opportunity for us to get close and in tune through the preached word to God's word. And God has a message for each and every one of you individually. He has a message through that. I don't know what your message is. He has a message that he's going to give to you through the word of God. If you'll just give him a moment of your time, block the enemy out right now. Tell him that you're busy praising God. Amen.
Amen.
And tell him you don't have time for him today. And whatever you do, don't answer yourself. Just say it in your mind. Amen. But tell yourself, I'm going to give myself to the word of God. Amen.
Amen.
That, what a segue, because we look at Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse number 19, we find the parable of the seed and the sower. And I don't want to spend any time going over and over the ground, because I think that the text is not about the ground. The text is about the seed. Because the ground is mentioned ambiguously three times in different ways, but the seed is mentioned 10 times. Therefore, it is important to stay with the theme of the text and the pericope of Scripture and to examine what it is that God is saying about the seed. You remember last week I explained to you in Lent about the process of the germination of the seed. That when you plant a seed in the ground, it remains a seed until it goes through the process of germination. And as long as the seed does not have the right temperature and the right light and the right nourishment, it will just remain a seed. And then we find the process and the danger of the seed is that if that seed remains on the top of the soil, it can become scorched. It can become, according to the very first verse, that when the sower sowed the seed, then the enemy came and he snatched the seed away. Because after the seed was sown, it was not able to be buried into the soil. And some farmers say that the bigger the seed, the deeper you plant the seed. But the text uses the word hapuzo, which sounds like harpoon, means literally that when God's word is preached, it could be happening this morning, that when God's word is preached, when the seed is sown, that the devil will catch it in the air and grab it from the audience, that the seed might not be planted. I don't know about you, but there are times when I'm in the house of God and I'm looking, I'm physically there, and I'm mentally tuning into the word of God, then something will come across my mind literally out of nowhere, and I'll miss something that was said in the preached word. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Every now and again, I come into the house of God, and I'm sitting down, and the enemy is using something or somebody to stop me from connecting to the word of God. Sometimes he uses me. Sometimes he uses my negative attitude. Sometimes he uses immaturity. Sometimes he uses problems. Sometimes, but some way, somehow, the word of God is harpooned from me, and I'm not able to connect to the word of God. I want you to know that according to the text, it is quite by design. The enemy doesn't want you to hear the message. He wants you to mess with the messenger. Y'all ought to say amen. The enemy don't want you to hear the message. He wants you to spend your time messing with the messenger. The messenger don't have a heaven or a hell to put you into. The messenger can't get his own stuff right all the time. Y'all ought to say amen. You're worried about the wrong thing. You ought to be listening for the message, the seed of God. And until you get the seed deep down in your heart, your life is going to be problematic. I suggest and I submit to you that most of our problems that we're dealing with in life right now is that we haven't fell in love with the word of God. We haven't fell in love. We hear the word of God. We ought to start blinking our eyes. I love the word of God. I love to hear his word. I love to hear his name. It's something about the name of Jesus that makes me want to shout every now and again. Something about the promises of God that gives me hope on cloudy days. There's something about the word. Oh, just let me hear the word of God. Right. Oh, amen. Walls, anyhow. Look at this text. The text says that when the word is preached, it is sown into the heart of men. The enemy cometh, that wicked one cometh, catcheth away that which is sown. This is that which is received by the wayside. But he that receiveth the seed in stony places. In other words, the stony places can be considered the time and time again. God's word has been preached unto you over and over again. You haven't become a member of the Lord's church. You haven't repented. You haven't asked for God's help. You haven't thanked God for his grace and mercy. But somehow between the sermon of repentance and redemption and the need of redemption and restoration, you took the word of God and set it in a stony place. What does a stony place look like? There's a thing that we say sometimes that a person is stonewalling. What do you mean stonewalling? Well, Sean, stonewalling literally means that the person has been confronted by the word of God. They know they're not baptized in the church of Christ. They're asked and given an opportunity to put Christ on in baptism. But they begin to stonewall and begin to make excuses about being baptized into the body of Christ. They heard the word of God. They believed the word of God. But for whatever reason, they put off the word of God. It's in a stony place that do not allow the word of God to penetrate their heart, lest they would be saved. In fact, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse before the 5 gospel, be healed here to them that are lost, and whom the gods of this world have blinded their hearts. I like what he says in John chapter 12, around the 39th verse. He said that you would hear the word of God, you would understand the word of God, and be converted, and I would heal you. Why aren't you baptized? I'm not baptized because I'm stonewalling. Why are you stonewalling? You don't have tomorrow. You've got the seed in a stony place. Amen. You need to let the seed go deep down in your heart. Do you love Jesus? Yeah. Do you need Jesus? Yeah. Are you in the Lord's church? No. Can you be saved outside the Lord's church? No. What should you do? Be baptized. Stop stonewalling in the name of Jesus. Y'all stop stonewalling today. You remember King Agrippa, I believe, Acts 26 and 28 or 28, 26, I think 26 and 28. Paul said, now King Agrippa, I know you believe. Every now and then I look at folks, I know you believe. I can see the end in your eyes that you believe. I can see by the way you treat folk, you believe. I can see the fact that you got up early this morning, you believe. I can tell by the way you sing, you believe. But why aren't you baptized? King Agrippa looked at him. He started stonewalling. He said, the reason Paul, almost thou persuaded me to be a Christian. I want you to know that the word of God can do you any good until you let the word of God sink deep down in your heart. King Agrippa cannot be saved just by believing. He has to take the word of God, allow it to go into his heart, and respond to the word of God. Romans chapter 6, you remember what he said in Romans chapter 6, thank God you once were the servant of sin, having obeyed that form of doctrine from the heart which was delivered unto you. Now while I'm preaching right now, the devil is doing what? Trying to stop the word of God. He got you arguing with me right now. You talking to yourself right now. But the Bible is still right. The Bible is still right. You ought to give yourself to Christ right now in the name of Jesus. You ought to be baptized for the remissions of your sins. But what I don't know about, why don't you know that he woke you up this morning? Y'all ought to say amen. Don't you know he blessed you in spite of you? Y'all ought to say amen. Don't you know that he forgave you of your sins and made a way for you to have forgiveness of sin on to the cross? Am I right about it? Don't you know he's been better to you than you've been to yourself? Don't you know he brought you through some troubled times in your life? Don't you know he loved you when nobody else loves you? Don't you know he's God all by himself? Don't you know he's Alpha and Omega? What don't you know? Get up and be baptized in the name of Jesus, every one of you, for the remissions of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Don't worry about it. They right? Are you right? Don't worry about it. Is everything perfect? Or is God perfect? The great perfecter, the great I am. He's worthy. Somebody look at your name and say he's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, praise God. I'm somebody. What y'all gonna do to see? What are you doing to see? In the process of the seed goes down into the ground or some stony ground. And we find that the seed remains the seed until, as I told you last week, until you allow the germination to take place. And I named some germs that you go through in order for you to become the plant that God would have you to be. I want you to know you're not going through what you're going through, but you're going through what you're going through because of where God is going to take you. But today I'm talking about the process in which you go through it. Inside of each and every one of us, when the seed is planted up, there is a little bit of embryo in the seed, which is an immature plant that's inside the seed. Amen. Just like us, when we're born again, we are in an immature state. We are not in a mature state, but we are little baby in mind and spirit. Then when the germination takes place, that is inside of us, that have always been inside of us, when it's touched by trials and tribulation, when it's touched by pain and sorrow, when it's touched by misery, when it's touched by disappointments, all of a sudden in the seed, when the atmosphere is right, two things take place. First of all, inside the seed, the plant sticks something out of the seed. Y'all better stay with me now. The seed sticks something out of the seed. One of it will sprout down in order to take root. Y'all stay with me. You want to talk about just a minute. The other part of the plant will sprout up to go up to the sunlight. And all of a sudden, that little seed will turn into a pea, which will then feed a community. Are y'all all right? See, some of the stuff that you're going through is in order to mature the seed, the embryo that's inside of you. If it had not been for heartaches, you'd have never rooted down in God's word. If it had not been for pain and suffering, you'd have never reached out to Jesus. I would lift up my eyes to the hills for which cometh my help. My help coming from my Creator, who made the heaven and the earth. He that created, he that made the Israel will never forsake me or leave me. Somebody ought to say amen right now. Amen. The reason that I'm standing right now is because I've been germinated. Some of them rooted down in God's word. Another part of me reached up for Christ and reached into the beautiful sunlight, that heavenly sunlight. Yes, and now, when you see me standing tall, it's not because I'm bad. It's because God brought me a mighty long way. Amen. Anyhow. And so when we look at this wonderful thing, we understand that the word is the most important thing that you have. Without God's word, you have no power. Without God's word, don't you know God spoke it
And it was. God said, let there be light. And there was light. God said, how many of you like catfish? Can you raise your hand? How many of you like buffalo fish? How many of you like tilapia? God said, let there be fish. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And there was fish. I like what he said, let there be barbecue. Say amen. Short ribs. And there were pigs. And y'all ought to say amen. He said, let there be the sun so we can see in the daytime. But let there be a lesser light. Then he covered everything, y'all. And there was a lesser light. And then he divided the day and the night. He didn't touch it. He just spoke it. And it was. Are you with me right now? God could just speak some stuff in your life and stuff will start happening in your life. Am I right about it? God's already spoke some stuff. God says, I will supply all of your needs. Am I right about it? And guess what? If you allow your seed to be germinated by the word of God, God will supply the sunlight so you can grow as a plant in the kingdom of God. God will cause the engrafting of his word into the root of the riches of his soil and his blood, and it will allow it to stand in troubled times. God spoke it and said that this blood is for the remission of sin. Sin has no more dominion over you. As a matter of fact, God passed on his speaking power. In the book of Romans chapter 3, I believe it is, he said that we're going to speak the things that are not as though they are. You know what your problem is? You don't know the word. You're going through stuff you need to speak against right now in the name of Jesus. You need to speak against sickness in your house in the name of Jesus. You need to speak against the devil in your life. You need to speak against poverty. You need to speak against wrongdoing. You need to speak against whatever bondage, whatever problem you're going through. You need to say the devil is a lie and the truth is not in you. The devil can't hold me back. Great is he that is in me than him that is in the world. You need to speak love and joy and health and strength. You ought to talk like you know Jesus. Amen. How many of y'all speak? How many of y'all speak in life right now? How many of you speak the word of God? How many of you speak the word of God? How many of you go up to your mountain and say, mountain, get thou hence? Why? He said, because God said, if you will say to the mountain to get thou hence, be removed into the water. He said, guess what? It'll get to moving. There's some folk in your way right now. You need to have a conversation with them. I need to walk somebody in your way to get thou in the mountain. He might not move literally in the mountain, but God will show enough to do what? He'll move your way. I wish I had some more belief. Am I talking some stony grounds? All right. Now watch. He said, those people with a stony heart, with a stony heart. And see, this is some of us. Look at this verse in Matthew. He said, the rough, the bread, the word fell in stony places. And he didn't hear the word. He or none. He received it from me. He agreed. With joy he received it. Next verse. Watch this. But it had no what? Root in him. What happened? But endureth for what? A little while. Haven't you ever been in church, been encouraged by the word of God, heard everything that God would have you to hear, but when the persecution came and the tribulation came, you start acting like Jesus didn't have the answer? Didn't I just tell you Jesus gonna move that mountain? Didn't I just tell you had speaking power? Didn't I just tell you God's given you the ability to speak stuff in your life? What's your head down for? Why are you wrong? What you crying for? Lift up your hands, oh ye kings of Israel. For God is worthy to be praised. And you heard the message. You believe it. You ought to live it when you walk out the door. Get home and the light bill is sitting there. You say the devil is a lie. But let me tell you something. You better pay that light bill. And you're going to be sitting in the dark. Amen. But don't you let the light be. Turn out the light that's inside of you. Are y'all all right? You said that this person, when it's received on stony ground, received the word, and as soon as trials and tribulation come, because of the word. See, the only reason the devil messes with you is because you received the word. So whenever you say, I got faith in God, I love the Lord. Whenever you make a bold claim that you're going to stand on God's word, the devil said, because of that word, I'm going to start messing with you.
All right.
Look at the text. He said, when persecution comes and tribulation comes, because of the word, I I decide to be a Christian, here come the devil. Yep. I decide I'm not going to drink more, here come the devil. You said what? Good as I've been to you, I gave you some gin that made me sing. Oh. Yeah. You had a nerve to turn your back on me. Well, I'm going to test you. I don't believe you're going to quit. You're not going to leave all of this stuff. But while you speak it, you better rest assured. The enemy is coming. As soon as you make up your mind, here he comes. The Bible says if your seed was planted in stony places, meaning that the reason that I became a child of God is because I was going through stuff. I was mad, and I did it in spite of them. And I said, I don't care, I'm going to be a Christian. I'm tired, I'll do it anyway. As soon as the test comes, you will fail. Then he says, there's another place that the seed fell. It fell on thorny ground. Sometimes the word of God is preached, and because we're human, we have the history. We have family dynamics. We have problems. Sometimes our hearts are thorny. There's somebody here right now that has a part stony heart and a part thorny heart, in which the thorns are the things that are sticking out from the rose. Somebody say amen. Not only does it keep people from getting close to you, but it keeps you from getting close to other folk. Underneath the thorns are the rose. And as you're standing there, because you've been lied on, you've been hurt before, the thorns are sticking out. And even when folk try to help you, they end up sticking themselves and they move back. You don't mean no harm, but you learn to protect yourself and to position your thorns properly. So when folk do stuff that then trigger experiences, you then transfer that hurt on that person by those thorns. Sometimes the preacher reminds you of the man that hurt you, and your thorns start to stick out and begin to stick in, because you're not going to let no man tell you what to do no more. When all he's doing is preaching God's word. Sometimes that little boy looked like the man that walked out the house and never looked back. And everybody been suffering in the house ever since that thorn grew and stuck up and started sticking folk. Won't let folk get close to you. The word of God is trapped between the thorn and the storm and the stones. And it's laid there ready to be germinated, but it can't produce anything with all that hardness and that coldness. Somebody said that Paul told Timothy that hearts were pricked with a hot iron. In other words, the heart need to be pricked because it's hard and it's cold. And this text says that there are thorns around the heart of man. And those thorns sometimes come from being hurt. You have a right to be hurt. You have a right to have sorrow. But every now and then you got to let the word prune away and cut some of them thorns down. Am I right about it? Every now and again, could you soften your heart? I know you've been molested and don't nobody know about it, but just trust in God's word. I know you've been let down and tried and don't nobody know the troubles you've been through, but just trust in the word of God. You gotta let it work on those thorns. It's not only keeping stuff away from you, it's keeping the seed from growing. It's stopping you from enjoying the power of the word of God in your life. I know sometimes you want to cry when you sit down and think about how you've been used and misused. But hold on to God's unchanging hand. Let him work on the thorns in your life. Let him work. Let him work on that heart. God's word will help you feel all right. Am I right about it? I know it's been hard, but a rose is still a rose in spite of the thorns. And underneath the thorns stand the rose of Sharon. Somebody ought to say amen. If you just get past the thorn, God got a rose inside of you. There's a church house full of roses that's made in spite of the thorns. That's enough to say amen. That's enough to say thank you, Jesus. Well, preacher, what are you talking about? You've got all the different places. Look what happened with the thorns. The Bible says that the thorns choked out the word of God because of the cares of this world. The thorns are seen in the worship service that make you think about bills and other obligations rather than the Lord who can save you and bless you. The thorns or members of your past right. that stand there and that make you forget how God brought you through everything you've been through. Yeah. What should I do? Trust the word of God. Yeah. Get to know God's word. Stay in God's word. Open your heart to God's word. Let the word of God dwell in you richly. The bigger the seed, the deeper you plant it. The bigger the problem, the deeper you dig in to God's word. Am I right about it? You don't leave the field. You come into the house, sat out and rooted in like a tree that's planted by the still troubled water. Y'all understand me? Somebody say, what do you know about the word of God? Well, I know that in all these processes that we've watched, the germination process, the migrating process, the agriculture process, there's still that process in which is found on good sand, good ground, good heart. That is what the word of God can be most effective. When we see and have a healthy relationship with the word of God. Oh, I'd be scared this morning if I was sitting here and I wasn't very acquainted with the word of God. Your power is in the word of God. Amen. Your promise is in the word of God. Your victory is in the word of God. Yes, your overcoming is in the word of God. Yeah. But you've got to allow the word of God to become the sustainer of your life. What do you mean, David? Put it this way in Psalms 119 and verse number 160. Thy word is true from the beginning. And every one of thy loving commandments, every one of them abideth, they abide forever. Again, he says, every word that you said is true. In Proverbs 30 and verse number 5, the Bible says, every word that you said is pure. He is a shield unto them who trust in him. Am I right about it? Once you got pregnant with the word of God, yeah, I said pregnant with the word of God. Right now, I'm trying to get folk pregnant in the church house with the word of God. Amen. With the word of God. And when you get pregnant with the word of God, the Bible says in 1 Peter 1, verse number 23, being born again, not of a corruptible seed, but with an incorruptible seed, which is the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. But when you leave out of here, you ought to be 9 months pregnant. When you ought to be ready to be baptized, if you're not baptized, you ought to be ready to say, I've been pregnant with the word of God. Stand up right now and shout glory and thank you, Jesus. If the word of God is found a place in you, can you just stand out and shout glory? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. It says the word of God, according to the Psalms, in Psalms 119 and verse number 11. The word of God have I hid in my heart that I might not sin. The word of God, Psalms 119, verse 105, your word has been a lamp, a light unto my path, a lamp unto my feet. The word of God in Psalm 119, again around the field verse,